course. Thank you, Dr. Ridhima. So I'm going to be talking about the diagnostic armamentarium for us as clinicians that we can use in the post-refractive IOP power calculation. At the onset, I have no financial interests in any of the machines or the techniques that I'm going to be discussing in this course. So as Dr. Ridhima has already mentioned, keratometry and effective lens position are the most important factors that are going to be used in the calculation of your axial length. So what are our tools that are available? Of course, it cannot be emphasized anymore that topographic data is a must. You cannot do with your normal K values from manual keratometry or an auto K value. And accurate optical or immersion biometry will do the job, whatever suits you best, whatever you are comfortable with and gives you your reliable results post-operatively. If available in an ideal situation, of course, we would love to have the pre-LASIK data, whether it's refraction or keratometry or both. In the post-LASIK data, what you want the most is the refraction prior to the development of a cataract, because otherwise the cataract, as we all know, will anyways induce a myopic shift. And the last but not the least is the availability and access to any online post-refractive IOL power calculators or any nomograms or any softwares that may have to be purchased, for example, in the IOL master. What is the best method for you? Whatever is available to you. So whatever clinical history you have to make the most use of it with the formula that we're going to discuss here on. Also, the available instrumentation that you have access to. What is the kind of an A-scan that you have is what you're going to use, and this is what I'm going to emphasize on further. If you do not know how to handle it, or if you do not know what you need to measure, if you do not have access to the instruments, do not hesitate to refer such patients. Otherwise, you might end up with a refractive surprise. Now, let's start with the online tools. There are many online tools. The easiest to operate is the ASCRS calculator, in our opinion. There is a quality IOL consulting program which needs to be purchased. And there's also a Hoffer subbing tool, which is essentially an Excel sheet. It asks you for whatever data you have, you feed in your values, and it gives you your result. Now, let's look at the ASCRS online calculator. You just go onto the website, and if you see in this corner, it gives you the option of post-refractive IOL power calculation. When you click on it, this is what it appears like. There is the option of prior myopic surgery, hyperopic surgery, LASIK or PRK, and prior RK. When you click on that, let's see what options it gives you. So it asks you to enter your pre-LASIK data, primary data of the patient, your pre-LASIK refraction keratometry, post-LASIK data, refraction topography. As you can see, the importance of topography. Now, this is what we are going to discuss from here on. Of course, after that comes the biometric data, whatever is available to you, either as IOL master or you can even put in your ultrasound value. So let's first look at the post-refractive surgery keratometry calculation. If you don't have a topographer, if you have a topographer. Alright, this will essentially depend on what do you have again with you. Do you have pre-refractive surgery data or do you not have pre-refractive surgery data? Depending on that, you will use what formula, you will decide what formula you're going to use and what IOL power you're going to use. So let's look at the first option, which is the clinical history method. The first and foremost idea of the clinical history method to be used is that you should have everything available with you. Your pre-LASIK keratometry, your pre-LASIK refraction, your post-LASIK refraction prior to the development of a cataract, and your post-LASIK keratometry. Basically, all the formulas, all the techniques have their own formulas, and you have to feed in those values into the formula and it gives you your IOL power or your keratometry. So in this case, it gives you the keratometry post-surgery based on a formula. If you take into consideration, go back to the previous slide, it asks you for a delta MRCP, which is basically the change in the manifest refraction at the corneal plane. Now how do you do that? You have all your refractions at the spectacle plane. So again, there's a formula for that. You calculate your refraction at the corneal plane using this particular formula. So you just feed in your values, where SEQ stands for the spherical equivalent at the spectacle plane. So let's take into consideration this example where you have K values, you have refraction and post-operative, pre-op and post-operative refraction. What do you do? First, you calculate everything at the corneal plane. You calculate your pre-op spherical equivalent at the corneal plane. Second step, you calculate the post-op spherical equivalent at the corneal plane. The difference between them is your delta MR, that is the change in the manifest refraction at the corneal plane again. And then you feed it into your formula for mean post-operative K. So given this above example, this is a messy slide just to elaborate on how you would have to calculate. It's a lot of math, like Dr. Dizima said. So you finally will end up with a delta MR of 8.77. And when you feed it into the formula, it gives you your mean keratometry post-operative to be as 33.23. As she already emphasized, these are flatter case because they have undergone a refractive surgery. Let's look at the next method. This is the phase minus method. This is very important because you do not require your post-LASIK corneal curvature at all. It calculates the IOL power pre-operatively using your initial K values and uses the change in the refractive error in its formula. So again, you just feed in whatever data you have, it gives you the IOL power that you are supposed to use. Let's look at the next value that we can take into consideration. This is the adjusted effective refractive power. Now, the effective refractive power is something that you get on your display map in the ICES technology topographer. So, in your topography, it's not your normal axial keratometry, which is the only thing that is important to you. It's very important to know your topographer inside out because you can use it for multiple purposes. One of them is this. So, again, you feed in your effective refractive power from the map, as you can see. In your ASCRS calculator, in the post-LASIK data, the first option it asks you for is the ICES effective refractive power. So what do? You get on your ICES something called a Holliday diagnostic summary. In that, if you can see in this lower left corner, it gives you the display of the effective refractive power. This is just what you have to feed into that slot on your ASCRS online calculator. What is the next? The next is the Malini method, which is the values that are used from the Humphrey Atlas topographer. In the Atlas topographer, you take the central topographic power, feed it into this formula, and it will give you your corneal power that you are supposed to use for the IOL power calculation. So this is the second box in the option, Atlas 9000 and 4mm zone. Now also in the display, you get your zonal values, 0mm, 1mm, 2mm, 3mm, 4mm. So it asks you for your 4mm because that is approximately what your mesopic pupil would be. Alright, the next value, as you can see, is from the TOMI. It is the anterior central corneal power. You just look at the display, you take, the average central corneal power. You take the average of the values and then you put it into the box. The last is the option for the Galilee, which is the total corneal power. Again, it gives you, every machine is going to give you this output and you are going to use it to feed it into that calculator. Now, if you don't have this, so if you look at the bottom, it asks for Atlas ring values, which we already saw in the Atlas map of 0, 1, 2, 3. If you don't have an Atlas and you have a pentagram, you can use that also. So you have to use your topographer smartly enough into feeding any of these values. So in the pentagram, you have the option of what is a Holliday EKR report or an equivalent K reading report. In that, if you can see, it gives you the option of a mean zonal EKR and it gives you the values in the 1, 2, 3, 4mm zones. So that is what you need to feed in again in your ASCRS calculator. Now there's a special importance of the EKR readings in the actual zone. Here, you can put in the zonal diameter whatever you want, whether it's 2, 3, however you want to calculate it, and it will give you the K readings in that particular zone. This at 4.5mm is particularly important for post-refractive IOL, post-RK IOL power calculations because you are looking at only the central cornea, the peripheral already has cuts into it. So this is particularly important for post-RK cases. Now, commonly available is our OptScan 2 topographer. In that, the normal display map is not really what you're going to take into consideration. What you are going to look at, as per studies, is the total mean power map or the total optical power. So you'll have to go into your settings, go into that map and look at the power at the 2mm zone or at the 4mm zone, which is very easy in an OptScan. You just have to take your cursor to whichever point you want to and it will give you the display values. Now, again, effective lens position, as Dr. Ritima has already mentioned its importance, I'm not going to spend too much time on this. We all know that it's important because certain formulas are going to use it to calculate the IOL power and thus it will compound the effect. The Arambari WK method, of course, skips the error that is made by the ELP because it uses, like she has already mentioned, the pre-refractive surgery K to determine the effective lens position. So this will definitely improve your accuracy of the IOL power calculation. Now let's go to the contact lens over refraction method. This is not really recommended anymore because first of all, you would require the patient's visual acuity to be more than 6/12. And second of all, you have to use a plano RGB lens of a known base curve and a known power. You put it onto the patient, you check his refraction. You see the refraction with the contact lens on, you see the refraction without the contact lens, you feed it into this formula and it gives you your K value. So like I said, each person has devised his own technique and each of them will give you a formula. You just feed in your values into them and it gives you the output. There are also multiple nomograms. By phase is what's being used. There's also a Cox nomogram, in which if you don't have any data previously, you just feed in your current K values, your current axial length, it gives you an IOL power. You use that IOL power and give an approximate idea of the change in refraction to adjust the nomogram accordingly. The Shammas PL formula requires a special mention because it does not require any historical data. So it will give you your K values accordingly. The ideal method, of course, is one in which there is no clinical history required and everything is measured as on date. Of course, we don't have any such thing so far, but we do have the calculators to help us. Now, what to use when? This is just a short nomogram. If you have the availability of the preoperative K, you have to look at what you have in the refraction. If you have refraction, your ideal method would be a clinical history method. If you have a refraction which is not available post-surgery, you use the phase minus method because you are only directly using the IOL power. If you don't have your refraction preoperatively, then you might want to use the double K method. In the second situation, you don't have your preoperative K value. So what do you have again? Do you have refraction? Yes or no? If you don't, use the contact lens or the Shammas method. If you do, use the phase minus nomogram. So this is just a simplified nomogram to give you an idea what is to be used when. And again, like I kept emphasizing, for each case, make the use of whatever data you have with you and feed it into the formula. So when you feed it into the ASCRS calculator, it will give you the output of the IOL powers that it has calculated and it will also give you the options it has used to calculate. So it will tell you the formulas that have been used using pre-LASIK data and change in manifest refraction, using only manifest refraction and using no prior data. At the bottom, as you can see, there's the average IOL power, minimum and maximum. Like Dr. Kumar already mentioned, you always try to be more myopic so that you don't end up with a hyperopic refractive surprise. This is when you click on the ASCRS and after you asked it to calculate, it will always give you a pop-up window and itself will explain to you what techniques have been used so that you have an idea of what's being used for your patient. In short, to summarize, if you have all your data available, a clinical history method. If you have no K pre-surgery, use a nomogram. If you have only K post-surgery, use the Shammas PL formula. So these three slides pretty much summarize the most important data. And this is your contribution as a refractive surgeon to the patients that you come that come to you and you do a LASIK on today. You would want to give them, apart from their normal topography data, which we give all our pre-LASIK patients, if you have access to an IOL master or a lens star, do not hesitate in giving the printout of this report to your patient because it's going to come to use to you or any other surgeon at a later date. Also, the post-LASIK stable refractive error records and the post-LASIK stable topography records would be something that you would need to consider giving your patient at least after a year of stability has been achieved. So now that you are armed and ready and you know what are your options available, let's move on to actual clinical situations which will be handled by Dr. Mukesh and Dr. Balu. Thank you very much.